through the cosmos, galaxies are dying off, and the question astronomers want answered is, what's killing them? New research by a global team of researchers based at the International Center for Radio Astronomy Research, ICRAR, has revealed that a study of 11,000 galaxies shows the gas-like blood for star formation is being violently stripped away on a widespread scale throughout the local universe. During their lifetimes, galaxies can inhabit halos of different sizes, ranging from masses typical of our own Milky Way to halos thousands of times more massive, said Toby Brown, leader of the study and PhD candidate at ICRAR and Swinburne University of Technology. The image we paint is astronomers is that galaxies are embedded in invisible clouds of dark matter that we call dark matter halos. As galaxies fall through these larger halos, the superheated intergalactic plasma between them removes their gas in a fast-acting process called ram pressure stripping. High-resolution cosmological N-body simulation, CosmoGrid, shown below lets you follow the formation and evolution of a lot of Milky Way, like dark matter halos. This movie focuses on the largest dark matter halos at zero current NIVs. The simulation was partially carried on CRI-XD4 at Center for Computational Astrophysics of National Astronomical Observatory of Japan. Tomoki Ishiyama, University of Tsukuba, Brown said, the other main process by which galaxies run out of gas and die is known as strangulation. Strangulation occurs when the gas is consumed to make stars faster than it's being replenished, so the galaxy starves to death. It's a slow-acting process. On the contrary, what ram pressure stripping does is bop the galaxy on the head and remove its gas very quickly, off the order of tens of millions of years, and astronomically speaking, that's very fast. You can think of it like a giant cosmic broom that comes through and physically sweeps the gas from the galaxies, Brown said. Removing the gas from galaxies leaves them unable to form new stars. It dictates the life of the galaxy because the existing stars will cool off and grow old. If you remove the fuel for star formation, then you effectively kill the galaxy and turn it into a dead object. Most galaxies in the universe live in these groups of between 2 and 100 galaxies, he added. We've found this removal of gas by stripping is potentially the dominant way galaxies are quenched by their surrounds, meaning their gas is removed and star formation shuts down. The study, published in the journal Monthly Notices of the Royal Astronomical Society, used an innovative technique combining the largest optical galaxy survey ever completed, Sloan Digital Sky Survey, with the largest set of radio observations for atomic gas in galaxies, the Arecibo Legacy Fast Alpha Survey. Archaeologists have uncovered a new cave that once housed Dead Sea Scrolls in a discovery described as one of the most important in 60 years. The Hebrew University in Jerusalem said the scrolls were missing from the cave, though, but hopes to find others. The Dead Sea Scrolls, which include the oldest known manuscripts of the Hebrew Bible, date from the 3rd century BC to the 1st century AD. The around 900 scrolls were discovered between 1947 and 1956 in the Qumran Caves above the Dead Sea. This discovery of a 12th cave could revolutionize the information we have on the Dead Sea Scrolls, Hebrew University archaeologist Oren Gutfeld told AFP, calling it one of the most important discoveries since 1956. The parchment and papyrus scrolls contain Hebrew, Greek, and Aramaic writing, and include several of the earliest known texts from the Bible, including the oldest surviving copy of the Ten Commandments. The cave discovered west of Qumran in the occupied West Bank contained no manuscript, but there is ample evidence of their earlier presence. This includes fragments of pottery in which they were placed, and the leather straps, Gutfeld said. Many of the caves containing the manuscripts were looted in the 1950s. Heads of pickaxes dating from that time were found in the cave, and another indication they had been looted, a Hebrew University statement said. We hope to find other caves containing or having contained manuscripts as part of the operation launched by the Antiquities Authority to carry out systematic excavations in the caves of the Judean Desert, where the Dead Sea is located, Gutfeld added. Many experts believe the manuscripts of the Dead Sea were written by the Essenes beings, a dissident Jewish sect that had retreated into the desert. Other scholars believe they came from libraries of the Second Jewish Temple in Jerusalem and private libraries sheltered in caves. The most recent scrolls date to around 78 when Roman troops destroyed the temple. The artifacts are mostly housed at the Israel Museum in Jerusalem, where some of the larger pieces are shown at the dimly lit shrine of the book. The shrine's white ceramic dome recalls the lid of the jars in which the manuscripts were uncovered. The universe itself may be finite, or may be infinite, the jury is still out. But one thing is certain, the part that's accessible to us is finite. Even with the expanding universe, even with all the galaxies and stars and planets and molecules and atoms and subatomic particles in it, there's only so much we can access. And those limitations, the total numbers of particles and the total amount of energy available in the universe, means there's only a finite amount of information we can determine about our cosmos. For the first time, we can quantify that and begin to infer which things we might never understand. One of the ultimate questions about our universe is the question of where all of this came from. When we discovered that the grand spirals in the sky were actually galaxies not so different from our Milky Way all unto themselves, it paved the way for us to truly, for the first time, understand the scope and scale of all that we can perceive. These distant island universes weren't contained within the Milky Way, but were collections of billions, or even trillions of stars, separated by millions, or even billions of light years across the cosmos. When we found that the more distant a galaxy was from us, on average, the faster it appeared to be receding from our perspective, an intriguing possibility opened up consistent with Einstein's general relativity. Perhaps the galaxies were not all speeding away from our location, but the fabric of space itself was expanding. If this were the case, then the universe should not only be expanding, but cooling, as the wavelength of light would be stretched to lower and lower energies as time went on. Moreover, we didn't just have to extrapolate forwards, but we could go backwards, too, to a time where the universe was smaller in the past. If we looked in that direction, we'd find a universe that was denser, hotter, more rapidly expanding and more compact. At early enough times, the universe would be so energetic that neutral atoms would be blasted apart, and even before that, individual atomic nuclei couldn't have formed. You see, there were a few major problems that arose. If you tried to go all the way back that far, the universe would be expanded into oblivion, or recollapsed almost immediately, never forming stars or galaxies, unless the initial expansion rate and the initial energy density were perfectly balanced. The universe would have different temperatures in different directions, something it was observed not to have unless something caused it to have the same temperature everywhere. The universe would have been filled with high-energy relics that had never been detected, a consequence of extrapolating back arbitrarily in the past. And yet, when we viewed our universe, it did have stars and galaxies, it was the same temperature in all directions, and didn't have these high-energy relics. The solution to these problems was the theory of cosmic inflation, which replaced the idea of a singularity with a period of exponentially expanding space, and which predicted those initial conditions that the Big Bang on its own could not. In addition, inflation made 6 other predictions for what we would see in our universe: a perfectly flat universe, a universe with fluctuations on scales larger than light could travel across, a universe with a maximum temperature that's not arbitrarily high, a universe whose fluctuations were adiabatic, or of equal entropy everywhere, a universe where the spectrum of fluctuations was just slightly less than having a scale and very intense one nature, and finally, a universe with a particular spectrum of gravitational wave fluctuations. The first 5 of them have been verified, with the 6th one still being sought. The next logical question about our origins, of course, then becomes that of where did inflation come from? Was it a state that was eternal to the past, meaning that it had no origin and always existed right up until the moment it ended and created the Big Bang? Was it a state that had a beginning, where it emerged from an uninflationary state in space-time some finite time in the past? Or was it a cyclical state, where time looped back on itself from some far future state? The difficult thing here is that there's nothing we can observe in our universe that allows us to tell these 3 possibilities apart. In all but the most contrived models of inflation, and some of those we can rule out, it's only the last 10-33 seconds or so of inflation that impacts our universe. the exponential nature of inflation wipes out any information that occurred prior to that, separating it from anything we can observe by, well, inflating it beyond the portion of our universe that we can observe. What we're left with is an observable universe that's huge, 46 billion light years in radius, containing some 1012 galaxies, 1024 stars, 1080 atoms, and nearly 1090 photons. The total amount of energy in all the particles and all the empty space in the universe is somewhere around 1054 kilograms, including dark matter and dark energy. But those numbers, while astronomical, are finite and don't give us any information about what happened in the universe prior to the last tiny fraction of a second of inflation. We can do theoretical calculations to attempt to gain some insight, but they are model dependent. With the exception of a few specific models that would leave observable traces in our universe, most don't. We have no way of knowing how, or even if the universe got its start. The total amount of information accessible to us in the universe is finite, and hence, so is the amount of knowledge we can gain about it. There's a limit to the amount of energy we can access, the particles we can observe, and the measurements we can make. There's a whole lot left to learn and a whole lot that science has yet to reveal, and many of the present unknowns will fall in the near future. But some things we will likely never know. The universe may yet be infinite, but our knowledge of it never will be. Thank you.